Hi, my name is Imran Huck, and welcome to another episode of The Voice of a Leader, the series where I interview high-achieving leaders, try and find out how they got to where they are. The demand for engineers in Australia far outweighs the supply of graduates. Each year, the country imports double the number of engineers that graduate from its universities. And of all the Australian engineering graduates, only around 16% are women. This week I interviewed Marita Cheng, who is the 2012 Young Australian of the Year and the founder of the company called Abbott. Marita, welcome to The Voice of a Leader.
Thank you. Thanks for having me.
So you're born in Cairns, Queensland, and you're actually brought up in quite a challenging environment, situation. So I believe your parents separated when you were really young, and then you were living in a housing commission with your brother and mother. But I was going to say, despite all this, I believe in 2006 you won Cairns Young Citizen of the Year award, which
yeah.
is a really good effort.
Uh-huh.
So the question I had was...
It was 2007 actually.
Oh, 2007, sorry.
It was a year, because I'd finished year 12 and then Cairns Young Citizen.
What did you tell yourself or what did you do during those times to stay motivated? Because you had a lot of challenges then.
I guess I just liked getting involved in a lot of things, and my mum was always encouraging me to do more and see more and experience more. And so I, learnt a lot of things and just got involved in the community. Mm. And whenever I learnt of anything that was interesting happening in the community, I'd just put my hand up and volunteer and go along and get involved. And I liked it because every time I volunteered or did something different, I learnt about a different part of Cairns or different types of people and different systems.
I was going to say, because was it really tough adjusting to not having a father around and stuff? Or
Well, my parents were separated when I was 1 month old.
You're really
So I didn't have to adjust.
Yeah,
it was
sure.
just I just always had my mom.
So as part of your studies, you did a Bachelor of Computer Science
mm-hmm.
and Engineering, so
yeah.
mechatronics
yeah,
in Melbourne Uni. So the very probably common question I have is, what made you want to decide those pathways instead of combination, medicine or law?
My mum wanted me to do medicine.
Oh, really? I'm surprised.
So actually, I did my UMAT. So
oh, really?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
We drove to Townsville together, all the kids in my school who wanted to do medicine or who were interested.
Yep.
We all sat our UMAT. And as a result of that, I actually got invited to Monash to do an interview at Monash for medicine.
Oh, I went to that. Very good.
And in terms of engineering, I really like the excitement and the adventure of it. And I read about the Google guys and Steve Jobs and Steve Wozniak in Time magazine when I was growing up. And I was really inspired that they created such big companies from nothing when they were in their 20s. And so I looked at their majors and they did maths and computer science. And,
and
I thought, oh, okay, I should do computer science. Mm. Then I thought, I'll do engineering as well because it's more applied and lead to better job opportunities as a fallback option. And yeah, and then I went to engineering camp when I was in year 12. I saw it, I read about it in the school newsletter.
Yeah, sure.
And it sounded fun. It said, interested in maths, interested in science, come to our engineering camp. And I didn't really know what engineering was, but I went along and it was really fun meeting all these people who were interested in putting things together and figuring out how things worked, just smart, interested people. And so after that, I thought I definitely want to do engineering.
Yeah, sure.
But Monash invited me to do medicine, so I went to the interview, and it made me realize that I didn't want to do medicine at Monash.
Sure.
It was in that interview that I was this isn't for me. And so I went back home, I changed my preferences so that it was mechatronics engineering computer science at Melbourne Uni number one.
Sure.
Number two was medicine at Melbourne Uni. And then the number three was medicine at Monash. And and I think that's quite funny. It's because I just bumped up mechatronics to number one and then I couldn't be bothered reordering at all. So nice. I don't know anyone else who has medicine as their second preference.
That's true. Something's wrong with this girl.
Yeah.
I was going to say, how did your mum take it? She was okay?
Yeah, sure. I got on the phone with her as soon as my interview was over and I just said, I'm doing engineering.
Yeah.
That's that. And during that interview, I'd made up my mind. I just thought, I just can't see myself going to medical school, memorizing everything.
It's a long time.
Doing my internships, doing my placements, just following that path to be a specialist. I just couldn't see myself doing that day in, day out. Whereas the thought of being an engineer and not knowing what my path was and not knowing where my career would take me, that seemed really exciting to me.
Ah, right. So you're more a person who likes more uncertainty?
Well, I think I don't know. I guess when I was younger, I thought that, you know, things were more concrete. Yeah. But then at the end of my first year of uni, I began to realize that the things aren't that way. They don't turn out
That's
how
true.
You think they will. And so I like to plan, have like really concrete-ish plans for the next few months.
Sure.
And, you know what I want to achieve in the next few months. But then after that, I think you need to take what you've achieved in those 3 months and say, okay, well, now that I know everything from these past 3 months, now that I can see the world in a different way based on those 3 months, what am I going to do going forward?
I was going to say, no, I think it's a pretty good decision you made, because I personally know a lot of people that their heart may not be in medicine, but because of family pressure and stuff, they get into it. So, no, good on you for doing that.
Okay.
And so the next thing I was going to say is 2008, make sure I get the date right, you founded Robogals Global.
Yes.
So yeah, you founded that because you wanted to encourage more like women to study engineering and technology.
Mm-hmm.
And you offered like workshops and talks.
Mm-hmm.
So I was going to ask from your point of view, your opinion, why do you think like many women don't want to study engineering or technology?
I think women don't want to study engineering and technology because, I think the ones that do, they're motivated by the projects that they get to work on and the impact that they get to make. So my company, we work on helping people through our robots.
Yeah, sure.
And so the people that I come across when I interview them, they say, well, I wanted to study because I wanted to help people with disabilities. I wanted to make prosthetic arms. I wanted to make robots that could help people who aren't able to help themselves.
Sure.
And so they have that strong intrinsic motivation to study what they're studying.
Hmm.
And yeah, they just think it sounds fun. And I think that's what we need to do with other young women. We need to emphasize that they're doing what they're doing to make a difference.
Do you think like a lot of them, when they see the ratio, like the low ratio, it deters them?
I think it does deter some. So I think the women who do make it and study engineering, they can hold their own because they're used to being the only girl in a class of 10 or 20.
Yeah, there'll be a lot.
But I think, I think that all women who become engineers, they're pretty tough. They're pretty strong.
When you were studying engineering, how many women were there? And they're like, for example, like a lecture?
So there were like 5 girls out of 50
in
mechatronics, engineering, computer science.
Oh, crazy.
Yeah.
I was going to say, what does Robogals Global actually specifically teach? So what do you tell them to encourage them to go into these fields?
So we bring robots into the classroom.
Nice.
And we get them to build them and we get them to program them and we get them to learn about programming and different programming techniques. And yeah, as a result, they get to experience firsthand what it's like to be an engineer. We also give them scenarios. So we tell them like, oh, this has happened. There's been like an environmental disaster or a medical disaster or a building disaster, construction disaster, environmental disaster. You need to use your engineering skills to solve these problems. And we're going to teach you a few bits of theory. And so we'll tell them about the different motors and we'll tell them how the sensors work. And we say, okay, now that you've got these resources, how are you going to fix this problem? Yep. And we'll say, well, actually, this is what people do.
Yeah.
And what you've just done was this disaster situation in this year. And people had to use these materials to come up with a solution, and that's what they did, and that's what you've done today.
Awesome. No, very good. I was going to say, you set up a branch in England as well?
Yeah, so I started in Melbourne, and then 3 months later, I went to the UK to study at Imperial College a year, studying mechanical engineering. And while I was there, I started up our London chapter, and then I thought, I really want to make this big in Australia before I do anything else. And so I came back to Australia, I made it big in Australia. And then that went so well that 6 months later I returned to the UK, expanded in the UK.
Excellent.
And yeah, then we had a lot of chapters and so we worked really hard to make our chapters as good as possible. And then after that, we expanded to the US as well.
How many people do you think women you've reached out to?
Girls.
Hey, Robogals.
We've taught over 60,000 young girls.
Nice.
Yeah, around the world.
Excellent. It's still, you're not like part of it now, you're still like, you're just like a member on the board at the moment, are you?
Yes, I've recently stepped down from the board because, yeah, they, as of last year, they began meeting every month, and because of my travel schedule, that became very difficult for me. So now I'm an ambassador.
Excellent.
And a special advisor to the board.
What's
a founder.
Oh, and founders, of course. What's some of the, say, short-term goals, Robogals? Just to keep expanding to more countries or...?
So, they're always expanding to new countries. But, I mean, short-term goals are to always make what we do better.
Yeah, sure.
Ensure that we're measuring our impact better. To stay on the forefront of engineering education, making our workshops engaging for young women. And to look after our volunteers so that they want to be involved
to
contribute and feel like they're part of a supportive community.
All right, good. So you've won like many, 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 many awards. you've done a number of TED Talks as well. But one particular award was the 2012 Australian of the Year Award, Young Australian of the Year.
So yeah.
I'm sure you heard this many times, but congratulations again.
Thank you.
I was going to say, I'm sure when you actually won the award, did you receive like a lot of confidence and encouragement personally and in the work that your organisations were doing?
Oh, yeah. We received so much support from the whole community, all across the country, from corporates to schools to universities, like individuals, parents. It touched a lot of people because if you're a father who has daughters, then you can see the potential you want your daughters to do well and to learn. If you're a mother, you want your daughters to do well. If you're a young girl, then you're curious. What is this about? If you're a university student, they want to get involved. And I was really grateful that I had Robogals chapters all over the country.
Excellent.
That could actually support and work with me to capture all those opportunities. So I would have someone say, "Oh, we want you to be in Brisbane on this day," or we want, and you know, at the same time we want you to be in Sydney, but on that same day I'd have a test in Melbourne.
Yeah.
And so I'd say, "Oh, you know, we've got a great chapter at University of Queensland, go and talk to them."
Yeah.
"Great chapter at UNSW, go and talk to them." Oh, and even in Melbourne, "Great chapter at University of Melbourne." And it was really fantastic because the impact that all of our chapters created that year, it just exploded.
Yeah, would it have given you, like, would it opened a lot of doors, wouldn't it, when you won?
Oh, yeah. I got invited to a lot of fancy events.
Oh, nice.
And I got to meet a lot of fancy people. So it was a very, very full-on year. I think I travelled, like, 3 times a week.
Is this interstate and overseas?
Oh, mostly interstate.
Yeah, 3 times, crazy.
I mean, I was studying as well,
I
didn't travel that much overseas. But I know that my successors they do a lot of overseas trips as well, and also my predecessors.
Yeah.
I thought I want to finish my studies. I want to keep going with my studies, and I also want to do Young Australian of the Year. So I just had to go in and do both.
Yeah, sure. You got to meet like Jeffrey Rush, didn't you?
Yeah. So he was the Australian of the Year that year, and so we did a tour together.
Excellent.
Where did we do it? So on Australia Day, we sailed into the harbour
on a boat
together.
Yeah, nice.
And that was awesome. I think our year, no one that was meant to be on the boat showed up. So the senior Australian of the Year didn't come. She was Laurie Bemuanga from Northern Territory, and so she was 92 and couldn't travel. And then there was a grandmother who was a foster mother from New South Wales, and she wanted to be back with her husband. So on the day it was just Jeffrey and my mum and I, and then
nice.
Two or four people or something from like the Australia Day Council in New South Wales. So it was this like huge boat, huge like New South Wales public.
Unlimited food and everything?
Boat. No, there was no food on it.
Oh, no food.
and there were like 6 people.
Awesome.
Or something. Yeah, 6-7 people.
Did he give you a lot of really good advice himself?
Oh, I just watched and learned from the best. So
nice.
I saw him. He was great. The media loved him. They loved asking him questions, and he always answered them questions so well.
Yeah.
And he's very smart, so he had a lot of experience and a lot of knowledge to draw on. So he gave very elaborate answers that encompassed geography and history and culture. You know, it was amazing to see that charisma in action in front of the cameras. Yeah, yeah. And very so good. I was like, okay, remember to, you know, try to do that kind of thing.
Do you still stay in touch with them?
I haven't recently, but I don't know. I texted him a couple of times over the years.
Excellent. I was going to say, with the Australian of the Year, you have to be nominated, don't you? Because you would have had no idea if you were nominated, did you?
So you get nominated and then you get a call to say that you were nominated and could you go to the state award ceremony?
Yeah, sure.
And that call came in like August or something. And the award ceremony was in November.
Oh, so that's a while before.
So I just didn't like think about it at all.
Yeah, sure.
And then, yeah, after November, when I became the Victorian Young Australian of the Year, that's when it started getting real for me. I was like, I actually have a chance. Yeah, it's like, this is real now. So that was a great year, 2011, the year before. I was really busy.
I was studying
full-time, running Robogals, and Robogals by that time was 3 years old. Yeah. So we'd begun to figure out what we were doing and hit our stride. So we had enough funding to fund all the activities that year. We began raising more money.
Excellent.
I mean, what we're doing. I'd won some awards from America.
Globally as well.
So I was an International Youth Foundation Youth Action Net Fellow, recognizing my work as a social entrepreneur. The Anita Borg Institute, so the Grace Hopper Celebration for Women in Computing,
excellent,
gave me a Change Agent Award my work encouraging girls into engineering. So, and that's an international body. And so I'd just flown back from that ceremony, actually, and then the Australian of the Year Victorian ceremony was the day after, and I was sitting my exam, so it was, you know, I was just doing a lot of stuff and doing RoboGas events every weekend and all the time.
Excellent.
And it was just full on. It was a great year. We just kept achieving so much stuff because we finally figured out what we were doing.
Excellent. And are you still involved in that process of Victorian of the Year? Like, do you get to nominate yourself now?
I don't. I mean, I've nominated a few people throughout the years. I didn't nominate anyone last year though. I go back to the award ceremony every year and I meet all the finalists and then whoever wins, I give them some advice.
No, good stuff. So you founded like a number of organizations and one of them was, so it used to be Tuma Robotics, it's our bot.
That's right.
It's Japanese, isn't it?
It is Japanese.
And Luxin Meat. And I think 2015 you released the first of a kind in the world. It's like a brain-controlled robot. It's called Teleport. And it helps, I believe, people with like restricted upper limb movement. And I think put it on their head and with their brain they can control this robot. And it gives them like the freedom to like travel and explore.
Yeah, that's right.
Now, it looks incredible. Can you like give me more information about it? Like what it does, how you came up with this idea and everything?
Yeah, sure. So our robot's called Teleport and it's a telepresence robot. So remotely, people can use it to explore museums, or if you're a busy executive or you work somewhere but you have to travel across the city to go to a meeting or go interstate for a conference or internationally to meet with a client, have a robot in your office and you and your team members and your boss and your colleagues, you can all log into the robot remotely, drive it around, go to meetings, talk to people. It's a more casual way to interact with your colleagues. So rather than saying, hey, let's meet at 4 p.m. Let's like schedule a Skype call and your friend saying, oh no, I can't at 4, I have a meeting at 4:15 or whatever, you can just like log in the robot at like 10 a.m. drive around, not there, 10:15 drive around, he's not there, 10:20 he's there now, go and talk to him, and he can say, oh, you know, I got a meeting at 10:30, but at least you've had that interaction that you wanted to have with him rather than like needing to wait until the next day to get your query solved. And that way it's not like, yeah, it's just really casual. It's not like, oh, it's a missed call on my phone from my colleague again. Sure. It's not that intrusive. And it's really, it's really immersive. So you drive it around and you can look, you can find whoever you want. You know, maybe that person that you thought you needed to talk to, he's not available. So you talk to like someone else on the team who knows something that you want to know. And so it's really easy to use. Just click through it on your computer screen and you can control it like it's a game. And So we thought, let's make this even more useful. We've done work before with people with disabilities, and let's make it brain controlled so that people with disabilities can just think and the robot moves.
That's incredible.
And so we made that.
That's amazing.
Yeah, we made it work.
So if you're thinking that you want to move forward, it'll move forward.
Yeah, so what you have to do, so it's a very simple brain control interface. It's called a mind wave, and it's got one channel as well as a movement sensor here.
Yeah, sure.
So all you have to do is concentrate over a certain threshold, and then the robot will move, and then you start off in forward mode, and then you blink twice, and you go from forward mode to, for example, left mode, blink twice, and then you go from like left mode to right mode, and then if you concentrate, the robot will move right, and then you stop concentrating, and then you blink twice, it goes into back mode, and then after that, if you blink multiple times, then that like makes it stop and it gets out of that mode.
Excellent. And how far, what's the furthest a robot can be from where you are?
Oh, it can be on the other side of the world.
Are you serious?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so you're here in Australia.
That's amazing.
What's the furthest place from Melbourne?
I think Iceland. It's okay. Actually the furthest country, I think, from Australia.
Okay, so the robot's in Iceland, in some bunker somewhere. And all you're connected to it via the internet. And all you have to do is, you've got your brain control device on, and you want to meet with your colleagues in Iceland, but it's a bit cold there, and you don't want to go there. And all you have to do is concentrate, and then once it gets over a certain threshold, the robot moves. So basically, this brain control interface, it measures your brain waves on a scale.
Yeah, sure.
And a lot of people use these for meditation. So they try to get their mind completely clear and be at zero. But what we've done is we've kind of reversed that, and we said, well, okay, because we can calibrate it, we're going to. And we're going to say that, you know, depending on how good you are at using this brain control interface, if you're over 60% or 70% and you're concentrating, the robot will move.
And it's straight out of the box as well, isn't it? Like, you don't have to like put
it
together.
It's so easy to set up. So we filmed our video in
which
one,
I'll show.
we filmed our video in less than a day.
Oh,
like
nice.
It was all done on that one day in like 3 locations.
Yeah, awesome.
Like all across Melbourne. And the people in the video, they'd never seen the device before. They'd never used the device before that day.
Right.
Yeah, it was the first time they'd ever used it. So unlike other brain control robots where the footage gets shot, like where they start working with these people months in advance, and they have to like train the brain control interface with their brain specifically for months and months. And then finally, you know, after 6 months, 4 months of that process, are they able to film it in a clinical setting and have it work? We went into offices, we went into their homes, and we made it work in their environment.
Very good. And so people can start buying it already?
Yeah, so our robot is available to people. We started shipping our robots in November last year.
Oh, good stuff.
And you can buy it on the website, or you can email us, info@albot.com.
Oh, very good promotion. I put all the details here.
Yeah.
What's do you have like another vision with this robot? Like more capabilities in the next, say, 4 or 5 years?
Oh.
Like going to Mars or something?
Like, I mean, we're already working on some really exciting things now with our robot. So we've got, one thing that we're doing with our robot is we're making it modular. So you can take off this head of the robot and put another head on have even more functionality. So you could use a virtual reality headset to control this robot.
Good stuff.
So you put on a VR headset, you look left, you look right, and the robot also looks left and looks right. Or it can do navigation by itself. We're working on robotic arms. So we've got a lot of exciting things planned.
I was going to say, from a business point of view, from the environment that I work, it'd be very convenient. Because like you said, if someone's not available for like a conference call, how are you supposed to like find them? Well, if there's a robot just follows them around.
Yeah.
Or if there's like a convenient place for them.
Yeah, get Johnny on the robot
that's
now.
Correct.
Yeah.
Do you have another product? It's like an app on the phone.
Mm-hmm.
So you're a co-founder, I think it's an organization, iPoly.
Yeah.
And this is quite incredible as well. So pretty much from what I've read, I think it helps blind people and people who are colorblind. So it's like an app on your phone. You put it on something and it'll just tell you the name of that object.
Yeah.
And I'm assuming if you press a button, it reads it out to you.
So, we went around and we spoke to 88 blind people and we built a very simple prototype first, and we asked them, what do you like about it? What don't you like about it? What can we improve? And we learned about how they use their iPhones. So they click something and then it tells them what they're clicking, and they click twice in order to actually do a click. And we built iPolly. So all you do is walk around with your phone and put it over an object, and it tells you it's a fist, it's a palm, it's fingers, nails. And that way, if a blind person doesn't know what's in a painting on their wall, they can just walk up to it, put their phone on it, and see that, oh, that's a pear in the painting.
Oh, even recognize the objects in the actual picture?
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
And so, we launched the beta prototype in January 2016, had over 120,000 downloads in seven languages.
Excellent.
And and the iPolly team continues to do amazing stuff. So they launched the second version, V2, a couple of weeks ago, and have even more recognitions, have even higher quality of recognitions. Yep. Category, so you can say, well, I know that I'm not around any animals, so this has to be like a fruit or vegetable, and then it'll be able to like segment through all its categories and its memory even easier.
So you can recognize, I don't know if it's this version or the newer one, 1,000 objects?
That was the first version.
Yeah.
And with the second version, it can recognize 1,000 objects, but then you can also like download different packages to recognize even more objects. And it's and the team's doing really great stuff. So recognizing like landmarks, monuments, like flowers, shops, stores, really amazing stuff.
Because what I've seen, you put on like on a dog, it'll recognize the actual type of dog.
Yeah, Labrador.
And how close do you have to be to the object?
If like this was like your hand, right, but you put the phone here, then it won't be able to see the context of what you're looking at. It'll tell you it's skin. So you just need to be close enough. I mean, the real innovation with iPolly is that it does recognitions in real time, and so it doesn't require the internet. So you can do it under the sea, you can do it in space.
That's insane.
You can do it in a vacuum. And so it means that, people in the poorest countries with no internet would be able to use this and use it reliably, and it will be able to do 3 recognitions a second, as opposed to using the cloud where it will take between 6 to 20 seconds because you have to take the photo, upload it to the cloud, have the cloud recognize it, and then send it back to you.
And then
you pay for each interaction as well. And so that's, 1 recognition per 6 to 20 seconds versus 3 a second, which is 18 to 60 times faster.
It's actually very handy without the internet, because if you're some remote place, and especially if you can't see...
It just works, right? Yeah, less moving parts.
So the final question I had is, we spoke a lot today.
Yeah.
And what are some words of advice you give to, say, women out there in order to encourage them to like venture into the engineering and technology space? Because it seems like a very exciting area.
I think you just got to take the first step and put one foot in front of the other and just keep going. I mean, I know that when I first started my robotics company, I knew that I needed to learn a lot technically still, because I'd built a few robots before, and I built a few robot arms before, but they were very simple. And I just started designing and then networking and asking for feedback from anyone who would listen. And they would say, oh yeah, you should do this or do that, or round this or round that, and or maybe make that thicker and make that thinner, and go to these manufacturers and get quotes from them. It's just doing that for a few years now. I'm a bit better at all of that. But I still got a lot to learn.
Excellent.
And I still have to talk to a lot of people and ask for advice from people who've had 30 years, 50 years more experience than me. To say, well, what do you think about this and this? And things say, well, I've done that before and it doesn't work, so you should avoid that. Or, I've done that many times, this is a better way. And
There'll be situations where there's like a robot or another product, people can get discouraged if it doesn't work after many attempts. What do you do in those situations to keep yourself going?
If a robot doesn't work after many attempts?
That's right.
I think you need to have like people around you.
That's
so important. I think, working with other people, and always just like creating that community around you that like encourages you. And I think that's something that that's a good lesson to learn, but then it's a good lesson to always remind yourself as well. Because, yeah, surrounding yourself with those good
positive
people.
Yeah, sure.
Well, it's not just positive people, but yeah, it's also people who work with you to achieve the goal. That's what keeps you going. You know, we've been around for a few years now, and so we've had a lot of time to figure out what we're doing. And so this year, I hope we get to show the world that, you know, we've learned a few things.
I was going to say, what was the reason for changing it to Abbott from Tuma Robotics?
I like the name a lot more. Yeah, I think Abbott's it's a great name. It's like Tuma Robotics, it just didn't sit right with me exactly. And so we went through this huge brainstorming session that took many months.
Yeah, sure.
And then I remember I was talking to one of my friends about it, and they said, oh, what about like a name like Abbott, O-U-R, B-O-T? And it just stuck with me. Like, and we did like, we brainstormed like 200 names that day.
Oh, no.
But while I was walking later, I thought, Albert, I really like that. Because that's what we want these robots to encompass. We want them to not be just about me or about you. We want it to be everyone's robots to help everyone. And I just thought, but there's a way that we can make that Albert look nicer, like just a bit cleaner. And I just kept thinking like, oh, how can we spell it in a different way? How can we make it just a bit catchier? And then I realized that AU is also OW, and I just really liked it.
No, it's just, it's a very simple name, and it's, as you said, it's catchy. Uh-huh. OWBOT. And people will remember it because it has like half the name of a robot in it.
Yeah. And then we don't have to like change a name later on from like OWBOT Robotics or something, because it's already got
That's
a bot
true.
In there.
Yeah. How did you get to my robotics, that name?
Well, it was named after my business partner and I, when we founded the company, Mark and Marita.
That makes sense.
But then he didn't want to continue with the company before I actually started it. So, but I thought, okay, well, I'm going to start this company. I don't have another name. Thought really long and hard about a name back then as well, but I couldn't come up with anything. So I just stuck with Tuma Robotics. But recently I thought, a year ago, I thought, well, we're releasing our product. We should have a name that we really like, and OWBOT really
I was gonna say
all
like,
of that.
Yeah, people wouldn't think this, but there's a lot to a name. If it's very catchy, people will remember and stuff.
Uh-huh.
And personally, I didn't
realize. What do you think about the name?
I do like it more than Tuma Robotics.
Yeah, yeah.
Because it's very short.
Yeah, it is.
And the logo is very simple to remember.
And it's not as like serious as Tuma Robotics.
Yeah, to be honest, it sounds much more technical. Tuma Robotics.
Yeah,
I was like,
does,
oh my gosh.
Whereas, like the numbers and the robotics, and it's all very serious.
It's like a password. You know when you put a password on something?
Yeah,
you can put like a number or a letter.
Yeah.
Whereas Abbott is very short. So personally, I really like that name.
Mm-hmm.
Excellent. Is there anything else you wanted to add about your robot?
Keep posted.
Yeah, sure.
Like our Facebook page, sign up to our newsletter, and we will endeavor to delight you all with as many cool robots as possible over the next
What I'll do is I'll put a link.
Many years of going forward.
Yeah. I'll put a link to your website.
Mm-hmm.
And I can promote iPolly as well. Because
mm-hmm.
that's got like a bird logo, yeah?
Mm-hmm.
Again, thanks for everything.
Thank you so much.
Best of luck.
Yeah, thanks,
Marita. Thank you for watching another episode of The Voice of a Leader. If you're wondering who's next to me, this is the very famous teleport that Marita was talking about. Quite a handsome thing. And personally, I'm quite keen to see all the potential that it has, and I'm confident actually it'll do really well. In relation to the interview, again, another very inspirational, incredible interview. Marita had a lot of really good advice. One that I really took away was having a good network of people around you. You'll have a lot of challenges out there, but it's good if you're having a low moment to get in touch with someone that can give you some confidence. Thank you again for watching this episode. Remember, if you or someone you know is a high-achieving leader and would like to have an interview with me, please send me an email at info@thevoiceofaleader.org. Don't forget to visit my website, www.thevoiceofaleader.org, so you can see all my interviews and be kept up to date with the series. Thanks again, and goodbye for now.